रेशियो एनालिसिस। वैसे देर आर टू कंपनीज कंपनीज ए एंड बी। ए इज हैविंग द प्रॉफिट ऑफ 100 लाख, बी इज हैविंग द प्रॉफिट ऑफ 1000 लाख, राइट? सो विच वन इज बेटर? बी इज बेटर, ओके? ए इज हैविंग द इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑफ 500 लाख, बी इज हैविंग द इन्वेस्टमेंट ऑफ 10,000 लाख। नाउ व्हिच वन इज बेटर? ए इज बेटर। ए इज बेटर बिकॉज इट हैज प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी एज कम्पेयर टू कैपिटल इज बेटर फॉर ए एज कम्पेयर टू बी विच हैज अ प्रॉफिटेबिलिटी एज कम्पेयर टू ए इज लेस। सो दिस इज द पर्पस ऑफ रेशियो। व्हाई यू आर एबल टू से विच वन इज बेटर और विच वन इज नॉट बेटर? बिकॉज यू हैव कैलकुलेटेड द रेशियो बिटवीन द प्रॉफिट एंड कैपिटल इन बोथ केसेस। सो A ratio analysis is an arithmetical expression of relationship between two related or interdependent items. A ratio is basically an arithmetical relationship between two related or interdependent items. What items, what ratio we want to find, that we have to decide that in which two items I want to establish an arithmetical relationship. Now, what are the objectives of ratio analysis? We do the ratio analysis for the financial statements to find out the various ratios related to the liquidity, profitability, and solvency, so that we can judge our profitability and solvency as compared to our profitability of the previous years, as compared to our profitability of the peers, as compared to the profitability of the industry average. Now, what are the advantages of ratio analysis? Why do we do the ratio analysis? Why is it important? First advantage of ratio analysis is it is useful in analysis of financial statements. It is useful in analysis of financial statements in a sense that with the help of ratios, we have derived the formulas for ratios, and it is helpful in analyzing the financial statements. It is useful in simplifying the accounting figures. Ratios put the accounting figures in the form of ratios, so it is easier to say that I have a 20% profit as compared to my capital rather than quoting the big figures of the profit and capital. It is useful in judging the operating efficiency of the business. On the basis of ratio, you can judge your operating efficiency by calculating the various ratios and comparing those ratios as compared to the industry standards. Useful for the forecasting purpose. Ratio analysis is very helpful in the forecasting. On the basis of the past year ratios, you can project into the future that if my ratio for the last year profit is 20% and I can assume it for the next year also. Useful in locating the weak spots of the business. By calculating various ratios and comparison of the ratios with others, your competitors, as compared to last year or compared to the industry average, it would be possible for you to locate the weak spots of the business. Helpful in interform and intraform comparison. Certainly, ratios are helpful in making the competitor analysis and the trend analysis. There are certain limitations also for ratio analysis. Ratio analysis would be helpful only when comparative study is required. If I say the profit for company A is 20%, okay, nice to hear. What to do for it? If I say that profit of its competitor is 15%, it means company A is performing better than others. It is having a profit of 20%, but others is having the profit of 15%. Or if I say that company A is having the operating ratio of 20%, while, or I can say, no, not like this, company A is having the operating profit ratio of 25%, company B is having the operating profit ratio of 30%. It means I am not able to operate my operations in an efficient manner. So that's the reason I am having the operating profits less. Less operating profit of 25% as compared to the higher operating profit of 30% which my competitor is having. So when I compare 25% with 30%, it means I am able to locate the weak spot of my business. If I say in isolation that my operating profit of 25%, it will not give me any result. It will give me result only when I make a comparative analysis. That in relation to my competitor, my operating profit is 25% only while he is having 30%. So it means there is some inefficiency which is there in my business due to which my operating profit is less. So this comparison can be done with a competitor. This comparison can be done with last year's, or this comparison could be done from the industry average. And ratios are based only on financial statements. So whatever are the discrepancies which are coming in the financial statements will automatically come in the ratios also. Ratios alone are not adequate. That is, ratios will only show you what are the problems and weaknesses or what are the good points. They will not show you any other action to solve that problem. If I say my operating profit is 25% as compared to my peer having 30%, ratio will only limit that information to 25% and 30%. Now, what corrective action has to be taken, that the manager needs to analyze themselves. Ratios may lead to window dressing. Window dressing is showing something which is not there. Means you are hiding some important information or something like that. This is possible through ratios. Reason being, we do not have any fixed standard for ratio. We do not have any accounting standard for ratio. Therefore, this window dressing is possible. Problem of price level changes. Problem of price level changes means the inflation factor. If I compare the current year ratio with the past years, then there would be a problem of inflation. That is the thing which could be bought in the year 2005 for 20 rupees. Now it cannot be bought in 20 rupees. It may be bought in 30 rupees or 35 rupees. So this is the problem of price level changes. Then no fixed standards. Ratios do not have any fixed standards. We do not have any accounting standards except for the earning per share ratio. there for which we have AS21 with us. So, what are the advantages and limitations of ratio analysis? Classification of ratios. Classification ratios in your book has been classified into the three categories: profitability ratio, standard. Profitability ratios are the ratios which are related to the profits. Thing has been made very clear that the principles, accounting principles, and when I say standards, I mean to say accounting. Accounting standards are country specific. Make the few things clear with you. Have you gone through the financial reporting chapters in your book? Vertical format of balance sheet. Vertical format of the balance sheet and the profit and loss account. Profit before interest, tax, depreciation. Less depreciation. This will give you profit before interest and tax. Less interest, give you profit before tax. Less tax. When I say tax, I mean to say income tax. Profit after tax. Some profit after tax. This is the hierarchy as per the Companies Act, which we have to follow. And it will have less preference dividend. have profit available for equity shareholders. So this is how the hierarchy will go down. No, PBITD is not equal to gross profit. PBITD is after sales plus other income minus manufacturing expenses minus administrative expenses minus all those expenses. Then it would come only before charging depreciation. Let's see the part of the balance sheet. Sorry, vertical format of the balance sheet. It is given in chapter 9 9.7 balance sheet. Chapter 9, tab 9.7 balance sheet. Chapter 9, tab 9.7 balance sheet. If you see, there is a horizontal format of balance sheet, schedule 6, part 1. It is running into several pages. Then you can find limited balance sheet as on again the horizontal format. Then after that, you will find a vertical format of the balance sheet. Vertical form of balance sheet. Header is vertical format of the balance sheet, name of the company, balance sheet as at. Are you able to locate it? Page 195, Ritesh says. Okay. It has 1, 2, 3, 4 columns in it. Particulars, schedule numbers. Figure says at the end of the current year, current financial years. Figure says at the end of the previous financial year. Is it the same what you are looking for? Okay, this is the vertical format of balance sheet. Nothing, vertical format is just a tilted format of the balance sheet that liabilities is coming on the upper portion and assets are coming on the lower portion. So liabilities are termed as sources of fund and assets are as the application of funds. So sources of funds would be shareholders fund, loan funds. Shareholders fund will consist of capitals, reserves and surplus. Loan funds will have secured loans, unsecured loans, right? Then this would give you the total of the liability side. Then application of funds will have fixed assets. Then it will have investments, it will have current assets. Current assets would be current assets less current liabilities. Then it will give you net current assets. Any miscellaneous expenditure, if it is there, then it will give you the total of the asset side. This is the vertical format of the balance sheet. Clear with everyone? Now, if I ask you from this balance sheet, what is the capital employed in the business? What is the capital employed in the business? These are the few things which we would be using capital. What is the capital employed in the business? Capital employed is the capital with which the long-term capital with which the business is running. So capital employed would be share capital, both preference and equity. Equity share capital, I will write it as equity share capital, plus preference share capital, plus reserves and surplus, plus long-term loans, minus miscellaneous expenditure, if any, present in the balance sheet. Right? This would be the capital employed, that is the total capital with which the business is doing. Then the another term which would be used is shareholders fund. Shareholders fund means the amount invested by the shareholders. Shareholders fund would constitute of the equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus. Equity share capital plus preference share capital plus reserves and surplus minus miscellaneous expenditure. Then there would be one another thing, equity shareholder fund. Equity shareholder fund is the amount invested by the equity shareholders. Equity share capital plus reserves and surplus minus the miscellaneous expenditure. Right. So these are the terms which we would be using ratios. So the first thing, profitability ratios. We will start with the profitability ratio. First ratio, return on investment or return on capital employed. One and the same thing. So what is the return on capital employed? Capital employed means the share capital plus reserves and surplus plus long-term liabilities. So we are including the long-term liabilities in it also. So Return on investment. Now you need not to be scared that what I have to cram these ratios or something like this. No. I will ask you return on capital employed. The question would be return on capital employed. The answer is there in the ratio heading itself. Return on capital employed. Return means profits. It means I have to calculate the profitability of the capital employed. I have to calculate the profit which is available on capital employed. So what is the profit available on capital employed? If I go back to this slide where I just now wrote this vertical format of the profit and loss account, what is the profit available to capital employed? Capital employed includes this. What is the profit which is available to capital employed? PBITD, PBIT, PBT, PAT, what? PBIT, right? This is the profit available to capital employed. No, PAT will not be the profit available. PAT would be after the payment of the interest. But I am including the long-term loans there. Interest is paid on long-term loans. So if I am including long-term loans in my denominator portion, I need to include interest paid also in their numerator portion. Then only it would be the correct profitability. So it would be profit before interest and tax divided by capital employed in 200. That will give you the profitability ratio, return on investment or return on capital employed. The next is return on shareholders fund. Return on shareholders fund means return on shareholders fund. Now, the denominator return on shareholder means profit available to shareholders. It may include equity shareholders as well as the preference shareholder. Now, denominator is shareholder fund. What is the profit available to them? Profit after interest and tax, that is available to them. So, net profit after interest and tax divided by the shareholder fund into 100. Then next is return on equity shareholder fund. Now return on equity shareholder fund, so my denominator would be equity shareholder fund. This should be equity here. I will write it equity here. Return on equity shareholder fund, it would be net profit after interest, tax and preference dividend. Net profit after interest, tax and preference dividend divided by equity shareholder fund into 100. Earning per share. What does earning per share means? That is, what is your earning per share? How much profit you are having per share. So earning per share would be net profit for equity shareholders net profit available for equity shareholders divided by the number of equity shares, right? Now I have written weighted number of equity shares here. I give you example like this. On 1/4/10, the number of equity shares in my share capital is 10,000. On 31/12, 10. I came with a right issue. I further issued 5,000 equity shares. On 28, 2/11, I bought back some shares. We came with a buyback scheme and we bought back 2,000 shares. So the number of equity shares which are lying in my capital structure is 13,000. 13,000 is the number of equity shares which are present in my capital structure as on 31/3/11. Right. As on 31/3/11, my net profit, which is available to equity shareholders, is, let's say, 13 lakh. What is my earning per share? What is my earning per share? What do you think there would be the earning per share from here? These facts which are given to you? Hundred. That is 13 lakh divided by 13,000. It means you give no consideration to the fact that these 5,000 shares have issued by you as on 31st December. Earning per share of these shares will also be the same as the earning per share of these shares on 1/4/10. The money which is brought in by these shares is as on 31/12. And these shares have gone out. So no consideration to that fact. Very simple calculation, 13 lakh divided by 13,000. Intentionally given. And intention is successful. You have to calculate the weighted average number of equity shares which are available as on 31/3/11. These shares have remained in the business for a period of 12 months. So it would be 12 by 12. Plus, these shares have remained in a business for a period of 3 months. That is January, February, March. 3 by 12. Minus, these shares have not remained in the business for a period of 1 year, 1 month. So 1 by 12. This will give you weighted average number of equity shares 12 by 12, 3 by 12 and minus 1 by 12. You have to divide this net profit by this weighted average number of equity shares. Now it is clear with everyone. So earning per share is calculated in two forms, basic earning per share and diluted earning per share. Basic earning per share is what we are doing here. Right? Diluted earning per share will come into the picture when we have the potential equity shares in our capital structure. Potential equity shares means the equity shares which have a right of, potential equity shares are those instruments which have a right of conversion into equity shares. That is, if any debentures, if any convertible debentures are there which on a later date can be converted into equity shares, that would be the potential equity shares. So diluted earning per share would be calculated by taking into consideration the potential equity shares. So this was about earning per share. Yes, Vineet, if it is required, you can calculate it by 365 days. That's not an issue. Then price earning ratio. Price earning ratio shows the relationship between the market price, relationship between the market price of the share and the earning per share. So market price per equity share divided by earning per share. Market price per equity share is the price at which the share is there at the secondary market, at the stock exchange. So market price per equity share divided by the earning per share will give you the price earning ratio. Then next is the gross profit ratio. Gross profit ratio is very simple to calculate. Gross profit divided by net sales into 100. Then net profit ratio. Net profit ratio is net profit divided by net sales into 100. If you want to calculate net operating profit ratio, it would be net operating profit divided by net sales into 100. Then comes the operating ratio. Operating ratio is very, very important for the manufacturing organization, because in case of manufacturing organization, operating cost constitutes the main cost of the operations. So if we are able to control the operating cost, then it will give you your margins of profits would be higher. Operating cost divided by net sales into 100. That would be the operating ratio. So just go through these ratios, what we have done till now. Then I will move ahead. Vineet, what are you asking? Why not net purchases? Which ratio do you want to calculate on net purchases? Is the profit margin built in the sales, or is the profit margin built in your purchase? Where is the profit margin staying? Yes, denominator only I am asking. Where is the profit margin staying? Profit margin is there in the sales price. So what is the profit in relation to our sales? Purchase is basically cost. Profit is always calculated over the cost price. Net sales is sales minus sales return. So what is the gross profit in relation to the sales? That will give you the gross profit. If you calculate the gross profit, there is no sense of calculating the gross profit in relation to the purchases. You are right in saying profit is always calculated as a percentage of cost. But purchase does not constitute the total cost. If you want to calculate the profit as a percentage of cost, then take it as a total cost. Total cost will include your purchase price, your adjustments for stock, your wages, salaries, other administrative expenses, all those administrative expenses. Calculate the total cost, then calculate the profit as percentage of that cost. You cannot calculate the profit as a percentage of purchases, because purchase is a single element of cost. You have to calculate the total cost, then only you can calculate profit as a percentage of cost. Gen less than SP. Yes, but it will be generally less than SP. Yes, it would be less than SP. Yes, it would be less than SP. Cost should be less than SP, otherwise there would not be gross profit. Then it would be very simple. Profit divided by cost into 100. Calculate the total cost. Now, next is debt service ratio. Debt service is the ratio. Generally, when you take a loan from a bank or from any other financial institution, they are concerned about the two factors. They have want to have a look on your financials because they are concerned about the fact whether you would be able to pay the interest on time and you will be able to pay the installment on time. These are the two things with which they are concerned when the banks and financial institutions gives the loan to somebody. So debt service ratio and debt service coverage ratio are the two ratios which are majorly looked upon by them. Debt service ratio gives you that is income before interest and tax divided by the interest charge. Debt service ratio basically shows that how many times your profit is able to cover your interest liability. That is, if your income before interest and tax is 1000 and your interest charge is 100, it means your profit is 10 times more than your interest liability. So this ratio is higher the better. Income before interest and tax divided by the interest charge. Then debt service coverage ratio. Debt service coverage ratio takes care of both the interest as well as the installment. So it will look at cash profit available for debt service, that is the profit converted into cash profit available for debt service divided by the interest at the principal installment. That is, ultimately the interest and principal installment have to be paid in cash. So you should have the cash profit for paying the interest and principal installment. So how many times your cash profit is able to cover your interest and the principal installment liability? Right. Next is payout ratio. Payout ratio shows you that how much of the profit is paid out as the dividend and how much is retained in the business. Generally, we do not pay out total profit as dividend. Some portion is retained in the business. So payout ratio would be dividend per equity share divided by the earning per equity share. Dividend yield ratio. Dividend yield is generally what the company does, they declare the dividend as let's say 20%. 20% dividend is declared by a company. Now 20% of what? Dividend is declared as a percentage of par value. 20% of par value is declared as the dividend. So par value is 100, that is the face value of the share. It means 20 is declared as the dividend. But this is from the company's side. But as an investor, what is your return? How much return you are getting? Is it 20%? Is it 20%? It is rare to be 20% because we don't get the share at par value. We generally get it at the premium. So dividend yield ratio will tell you what is your actual yield on the price. That is dividend per share divided by market price per share. That will give you dividend yield ratio. Okay, this was the profitability ratios. Yes, what was the question? For DSR, it's income and not the profit. And income means operating profit or sales. Income means profit only. This is profit. Profit before interest and tax. Income and profits are one and the same. Any doubt in any of the profitability ratio? Many, one by one. Certainly, there is a standard condition that lecture is always assumed to be read with. Means, it is always assumed at the graduate and the postgraduate level that when you are coming to attend the lecture, the professor should assume that you have read with that topic. And that's the reason that we give the class plan in advance. We tell you what we intend to do in the next class. So if you would have read this topic, these many questions could have been answered. Anyways, we can carry on. Let's start with the turnover ratios. First turnover ratio is fixed asset turnover ratio. Now, fixed asset turnover ratio the purpose of calculating the turnover ratios is basically to see how much assets you are maintaining in relation to the sales. So fixed asset turnover ratio will tell you net sales divided by fixed assets. That is how much sales you are having in relation to the fixed assets. Now what is the purpose of it? Suppose I am having the fixed assets worth rupees 1 crore. These fixed assets are in the form of building, machinery and land, all this thing. I am having the fixed assets worth rupees 1 crore. Is this 1 crore giving me any return? How can this 1 crore give me return? My 1 crore rupees is blocked in fixed asset. Now, if I would have invested this 1 crore instead of building in a bank account, it would have given me interest. So, what is the way out that I can have the earnings from this 1 crore by investing it in the fixed asset? Any way out which you can think upon? My 1 crore rupees, I have taken a building and machinery for 1 crore rupees. Now these are buildings and machinery are fixed assets. So I have purchased the building and machinery. So my funds to the extent of 1 crore is blocked in fixed asset. Now what is the way out that I can have the return from this 1 crore? If instead of purchasing the building and machinery, I would have invested it in a some investment that would have given me the interest. So what is the way out that I can have the profits from this 1 crore? By releasing cash? No, not at all. By putting it into the business, that's right. It is already put into the business. I have purchase the building and machinery. You cannot rent it out. You are conducting your own business. You cannot sell it. You cannot lease it. You want to conduct your business there. Okay, by employing people for the business. Employing people means paying salaries to them. Yes, we are earning profits through this investment. Now, whether I am earning profits through this investment or not, how can I judge whether the profits which are earned by this investment is sufficient or not? Profits would be on sales. So this ratio, fixed asset turnover ratio, basically tells you how much sales I am generating by maintaining this fixed assets. If from 1 crore of fixed assets, I am generating 100 crores of sales, okay? And my competitor is generating 150 crores of sales by investing 8 crores in the fixed assets. It means there are some idle funds which are blocked in my fixed assets. Is it clear? So fixed asset turnover ratio basically shows you that how much of the fixed assets are generating the sales. What is the profitability? What is the sales to fixed assets ratio? Similarly, working capital turnover ratio. Working capital is the funds blocked in current assets and current liabilities. Again, working capital is CA minus CL. That is current assets minus current liabilities, or we can say the net current assets. Now, these are the funds which are again blocked in the business. The only way to generate profits on these funds is to generate the sales from it. Now, working capital turnover ratio will tell you how much sales I am having in relation to working capital. Right? Debtors turnover ratio. Debtors turnover ratio basically tells you how much credit sales you are having in relation to the debtors which you are maintaining. Now, debtors turnover ratio would be credit sales divided by the average accounts receivable. Average accounts receivable is the opening debtor plus closing debtor divided by 2. We take the average here to make a more clear, to have a more clear picture of the debtors, because there may be a possibility that during the end of the year you are having debtors. So if I calculate it by closing debtor, then it may give a misleading picture. So we take an average of the debtors. And in any question, the average debtors information is not available, that is opening debtors information is not available, then in that case you can take the closing debtors as the average debtors. Then debt collection period. Average accounts receivable divided by the credit sales into 365. Debt collection period will show you the period in which you are able to collect your debtors. Average accounts receivable divided by credit sales into 365. Then creditors turnover ratio. Creditors turnover ratio basically shows you how much credit purchases you are having in relation to the creditors in your book. So, credit purchases divided by the average accounts payable. Average accounts payable is again the opening plus closing divided by 2. In case the information regarding the opening and closing is not available, then you can take the closing creditors as the average accounts payable. Payable is the creditors. Receivable is the debtors. Average age of payables. Average age of payables is the number of days in which you are making the payment. So, average accounts payable divided by credit purchases into 365. If you multiply it by 365, it will give you number of days. If you multiply it by 12, it will give you number of months. Stock turnover ratio. Stock turnover ratio tells you how much inventory you are maintaining in relation to sales. So, stock of turnover ratio would be cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold would be sales minus GP. Or it could be sales also. any of the figures can be taken, any of the amount of the sales or on the cost of goods sold, any of them can be taken divided by the average inventory. Average inventory is opening inventory plus closing inventory divided by 2. And in the absence of the information to calculate the average inventory, you can take the closing inventory as the average inventory only. So this was the turnover ratios. Any questions relating to turnover ratios? Both of them are correct. That's the reason that ratios does not have any fixed standards. This is the reason that why I said it can lead to window dressing. It does not have standards. Both of them are correct. We can say cost of goods sold. I can have a view that sales divided by average inventory should be the stock turnover ratio. Okay, because the profit is inbuilt in the sales. Or I can have the view cost of goods sold related to the average inventory, because the inventory which is to be maintained in the business is relation to the cost of the goods. In case of inventory, we are not having the profit portion in the inventory. So both of the views are correct. Both of the things are correct. Whatever information is available in the question, calculate it accordingly. That's why it is said there are no fixed standards for ratios, because different views, and as such we do not have any legal compulsions of calculating the ratios. It is for our analysis purpose only. So I hope turnover ratios are clear with everyone. Credit sales are the sales made on credit basis, because debtors come from credit sales only, not from the cash sales. Let's come to the financial ratios now.